My name is Dave Wabowski. I started working on IPSec back in the OS 390 V1 R8 time frame, so end of 1990s. At that time, our IPSec implementation was split across the OS 390 firewall technologies and the communication server. And the ZOS V1 R7 timeframe, we changed that and we fully integrated the IPSec technology into the COM server. I continued to work on the COM server implementation up through the V1 R12 timeframe. Today I'm going to take you through a set of slides that kind of morphed over the years, and the credit for the slides go to a number of people in the IPSec team, but the primary author is Lynn Overby, and so I'd like to thank Lynn for letting me borrow the slides. Moving to slide 3, you'll see that I'm going to start off with a brief introduction to IP security on ZOS, and to then move into the specific topics of IP filtering and IPSec. Then I'm going to mention a few things that are special to our IPSec implementation or special IPSec considerations. Then I'm going to have a very brief discussion of IP security and its displays and controls. And then we're going to talk about configuring IP security and enabling it on the platform. And we're going to fly through a bunch of foils on when I get to that point in the presentation. Okay, on slide 5, first thing I'll mention is that when we talk about IPSec, what we're really talking about, or we talk about ZOS IP security, is our implementation of an evolving set of standards known as IPSec. Generally, when you see IPSec in the standard world, it will have a lowercase s, and generally when we talk about IPSec, we capitalize the S, so it's capital I, capital P, capital S, EC is what we refer to. For the most part, it's fine to think of our implementation and the standard as interchangeable terms. They're fairly equivalent. As I mentioned earlier, we have a full integrated implementation of IPSec in the communication server. IP filtering is really a subset of the IPSec standard. And IP filtering is used to restrict data that enters or leaves the system. Another bulk of the IPSec security protocol deals with cryptographically protecting data as it traverses the network segments. And that's what most people think of when they hear the term IPSec. IP security implementation addresses both filtering and the cryptographic aspects of the IPSec standards. That's the reason why it's really fine to think about the standards and our implementation as being interchangeable. However, I do need to point out that there are optional aspects of the IPSec protocol that we may not have implemented. And likewise, there are features of our IPSec implementation that are above and beyond what's required by the standards. And an example of that would be our FWASA support, system-wide the security associations, which I'm going to talk about later in the presentation. But that's something that we did that's above and beyond the standards. Okay, moving on to slide 6, you'll see that we do have a pretty robust implementation. We support both host and gateway roles, but we are really optimized for the host role. We provide support for NAT traversal, and I'll discuss more about host gateway and NAT traversal later on. We also support IPv6 and IPv4. We provide a GUI to simplify the specifications of IPSec policy. But you don't have to use that GUI. You could directly edit the local configuration files if that's what you're more comfortable with. We have the concept of a default policy that is really in place while the regular policy is being loaded, and I'll talk more in detail about that in slides. You'll see we have a robust set of cryptographic algorithms that we support, and we also provide ZIP-assisted IPSec. We provide an NMI interface that allows monitoring of our IPSec implementation, and you can see that the Tivoli Omega Man XC from mainframe networks uses that NMI to display information about our IPSec. We do support the most recent levels of the RFCs, and last but not least, we have successfully completed some U.S. government V6 interoperability testing that includes our, the IPSec and the IC and the ESP test suites. So the suites that really test the IPSec aspect of our IPv6 implementation. The heart of the our IPSec implementation here is the TCP/IP stack, and it's where all the decisions are made relative to IPSec. It's where we do the filtering, it's where we do the encryption, decryption, it's where we do the authentication of packets that we receive. The policy agent provides policy to the stack, so it tells the stack pretty much what to do or how to make those decisions it makes. Policy agent gets its information from this local IPSec policy configuration file, which, as I mentioned, we have a GUI tool that could generate that file for us called the Config Assistant for ZOS Communications Server. IC and the IPSec command also kind of have input in telling the stack what to do. Security associations are really to tell the stack how to protect a particular packet, and we could either manually or statically define them here in the left-hand or the middle box, and in the right-hand box it shows that we could dynamically define SAs. The IPSec command is used to look at SAs that are in filter rules that are in the stack. It's also used to control filters and SAs. So, for example, I could say I want to create a new SA from the IPSec command. I mentioned that there was a missing piece to this picture, really. We should have had a little box up here for the TCP/IP profile. That's where you actually specify that you want to use IP security in a particular stack, and it also is where you define those default rules that I mentioned on an earlier slide. And as the stack is processing packets and it makes decisions, we could have the stack log those decisions. Those decisions go into a log buffer in the TCP/IP stack, and then there's another daemon that runs called the Traffic Regulation Manager daemon, and he pulls those log records up and then writes them to syslogd, and then syslogd essentially captures them somewhere on a disk, whether it's a local system or a remote system. So now we're going to take a deeper dive into the IP filtering aspect of all this. And on slide 9, you see that there are two diagrams on this page. And what it's trying to illustrate is really the concept of routed traffic versus local traffic. So if an inbound packet is not destined to an application on the box, or if it didn't originate from an application on the box, it's being routed. It's going to another location. And same thing for outbound packets. And obviously, when we're routing traffic, we're functioning as a gateway, and we say the traffic is routed. If traffic originates from an application on the box or is destined to an application on the box, then we call that local traffic. And when we have local traffic, we're functioning as something called a host. As packets flow through the IP stack, we make filtering decisions based on conditions. Those conditions include things like packet information, network attributes, and time. So an example of a packet attribute might be a source or a destination IP address. An example of a network attribute could be whether or not it's routed traffic or local traffic. And an example of time could be time of day or day of week. When a packet matches a condition, we then take an action. Possible actions that we have here are to permit the packet, just let it go through as it is, or we could deny. Sometimes we call this drop a packet, which says we don't want this packet to go where you're trying to send it, or we could say on permit that I want to permit this, but only if it has been protected with IPSec. And as I mentioned, there's two forms of IPSec, manual and dynamic, and we'll talk about those in more detail. And no matter what we do with a action, we always have the capability of logging a decision that was made based on a matching packet filter. So, on slide 10, this is just a pictorial description of what I mentioned on the previous slide. We see that when IP filtering is enabled, a set of rules is consulted. Those rules are known in IPSec terms as the Security Policy Database, or the SPD. For our purposes, you can think of the SPD as that configuration file I showed you on the prior screen. Rules are made up of conditions and actions, as I mentioned. A condition could be something like, if I see an IP packet with a source IP address of 1.1.1 and destination address of 2.2.2, take a particular action. And as I mentioned, actions are things like drop the packet or permit the packet or permit with IPSec. A couple of interesting things down here that you need to be aware of down on this box is that rules are searched from top to bottom the way they are in the configuration file. When we find the match, that's what we do. So first match wins. So this really means that care needs to be taken when you define your rules to put more specific rules up on top before you have more general rules. Otherwise, if you hit a general rule, you would never get to the more specific rule. So now we're going to move on to slide 11. And slide 11 shows that on ZOS, we have two sources of the SPD, or the Security Policy Database. The first source is those default IP filters that I mentioned earlier. Default IP filter policy is defined in the TCP/IP profile. It's very limited in nature and its capabilities. Certain criteria that I mentioned earlier, such as time conditions, are not supported. We only allow actions of permit to be defined, so you can't use IPSec with these rules. There's no way to say I want to deny a particular packet, but with both types of SPDs, there's always an implicit deny filter rule at the bottom of the rules, and you get that no matter what. And what that means is that anything that hasn't been explicitly permitted by the policy in effect is denied. The intent of the default policy is really just to limit access while that second source of the SPD is being loaded. Remember, I told you that comes from pageant, and it takes time for the pageant daemon to come up and load the policy and put it into the stack. So while that's going on, we put these default rules in. These default rules are put in as before any of the interfaces come up, so it's secures the stack while we're waiting for real policy to come in play. You might want to know, why don't we just deny everything? That's what I think the firewall technologies might have done. And the reason we don't do that is because there's probably some things you want to enable to get to the box just in case policy has a problem coming up. For example, there might be a managerial port that you want to connect from in order to fix the problem with the policy agent files if there were a problem. So that's really the whole purpose of default IPSec policy, is just to protect things while the stack is coming up, while everything's coming up, while pretty much pageant's coming up, policy agent. The second source of the SPD is really the policy agent IPSec configuration file. And as I mentioned, you can generate these rules from the configuration assistant. This is where the full function of IP filtering is in effect. It allows you to do all rules, permit, deny, and IPSec actions. And it also has a implicit deny rule associated with it. So anything not explicitly permitted by the policy agent policy will be denied. Normally, the default policy filter is only in effect until the policy agent gets a chance to load policy. However, you see up here that the IPSec command does allow you to switch between the two policies. You might want to do that in case you realize that there's something wrong with your policy agent policy that you don't like, and you want to switch back to the more secure default policy. So let's see. The important thing to remember is both types of these SPDs have an implicit filter rule at the bottom that deny everything. So, moving on to slide 12, there's a pictorial view of the previous slide. It just pretty much reinforces what I said. We have the configuration assistant generates policy for pageant, and that loads into the policy when pageant, or into the stack when policy agent comes up. While policy agent is coming up, we actually have the TCP/IP profile, which has default filter rules in them. As you can see, the stack actually keeps both sets of policy in place, and it's the IPSec command, which really tells us which one is in effect at a particular instance in time. And by default, once policy agent loads its policy, its policy will be in effect. Probably an important thing to point out on this slide is this little box over here that really tells you that, it reminds you that in order to enable IP security, that you have to specify on the IP config statement the IP security option, and likewise, for an IPv6 stack, you have to specify the IP security option on the IPv6 config statement in the TCP/IP profile. Slide 13 just summarizes the criteria that could be used when creating a condition for a IPsec security filter policy rule. Most of these criteria are self-explanatory. Maybe the only one that might not be obvious is the link security class down here. Link security class allows you to group a bunch of interfaces with similar security requirements together and then write conditions that apply to all those interfaces. For example, In the firewall technology days, we had the concept of a secure interface and a non-secure interface. So if you wanted to do that in our integrated IPsec solution, you would define one security class that you group all your secure or things connected to the enterprise network to, and then everything that goes out over the internet you would put in the other security class, and that would become like a non-secure class. And then you might define rules that say, well, I'll permit telnet from a secure interface, but I'll deny it if it comes from an unsecure interface. So that's the purpose of link security class. Now I'm going to transition from the topic of filtering in general to the more specific topic of permit with IPsec. Remember, I say that IPsec is really just a subset or another action that you can take when you're doing filtering. So it's really a subset of filtering, but it's a very specific and important subset of filtering. On slide 15, you see that earlier I mentioned that the IPsec is an evolving set of standards. Those standards are published by the IETF, or the Internet Engineering Task Force. And when they publish them in forms of RFCs. So you've heard me mention the term RFC before, and you'll hear me mention it throughout the presentation. RFC is a request for comments. They actually document proposed standards or protocols that have been agreed to by a working group. Specifically, when we talk about IPsec, there are two working groups that are kind of interest. The original working group was the IPsec working group, and that's now concluded and has been replaced by an IPsec maintenance working group, which is still active and actually is what is used to enhance the specification throughout time. There are two IPsec security protocols that are used to protect data as we send it between security endpoints, and those are the AH and the ESP protocols. AH stands for authentication header, and ESP stands for encapsulating security protocol. They both rely on security endpoints agreeing to use the protocol and to agree to the parameters that will be used when using the protocol. And it's kind of a recipe for how to protect your data, and that recipe in RFC terms is known as a security association. So I mentioned the term security association a couple of times, and that's really just the agreement that we make on how we're going to protect data across two security endpoints. I've also mentioned before that security associations could be manually created, or they could be automatically created or dynamically created. We call them dynamic SAs when we create them. And we use something called the Internet Key Exchange, or IKE, which is yet another IETF protocol that describes a method for dynamically managing SAs. So moving on to slide 16, we see that IPsec SAs are used for protecting data and that they're unidirectional. So that's what these little tunnel things, these little pipes are showing, is that's a, we call them a tunnel, that is data that's being protected through a particular communication path. And SAs can be wide or narrow in nature. A narrow SA is when you're going to use the SA to protect both endpoints of the communication path or the connection. So the top line here is showing a narrow SA. It's a very specific SA that we're using to protect a particular connection. It could, a wide SA could be used to protect the multiple connections. So there are various forms of wide SA. I could say I want to protect all traffic between two endpoints, or I could just say I want to protect all TCP traffic between two endpoints. And we would consider that wide because it protects more than one connection. Down here we talk about the ways that these packets, when we construct them to protect, these IPsec packets are constructed. They're constructed in one of two ways. It's either transport mode or tunnel mode, and we'll see that in a little bit more detail on next slides. When an SA protects data from the point of origination to its destination, so that's this top tunnel up here, it could use either transport or tunnel mode. But if we're doing something where we're just protecting traffic that originates from this client and protection picks up at this firewall and ends at this firewall, we would have to use tunnel SA in that case. Slide 7 shows the IPsec roles that ZOS can play. The typical use cases are shown at the top of the diagram. We typically are a host. That's what we view ourselves as being. And by that, I mean that the security endpoint, where the IPsec protection is occurring, is the same place where the data is originating or the connection terminates. So in the first example, we have something known as host-to-host end-to-end security association. That means that the data is originating from ZOS in this particular example, is being protected as in ZOS, and it's going all the way to this host, and it's protected all the way to that host, and the host is the data endpoint also. We have host-to-gateway scenarios where we're the host, and we protect the traffic to a gateway, and behind the gateway is the close in the clear to another host. On the bottom, we show the gateway scenarios that we support. Again, this isn't what we think are typical use cases, but we support these scenarios where we have a ZOS that is protecting traffic that's on a network behind it, and as it flows out to the internet, it's protected over to a host or to another gateway. So that's gateway to host and gateway to gateway. Those terminologies, when I use them, these are the pictures that are you should have in mind. As I mentioned on the previous foil, when we're doing host-to-host, we could use transport mode or tunnel mode. When we're doing host-to-gateway or gateway-to-gateway or gateway-to-host, you have to use tunnel mode. The next slide, on slide 18, basically shows the difference between tunnel mode and transfer mode of encapsulation. Now, encapsulation is just a fancy word to say how the IPsec packet is being built. And I'm not going to go over the details on these foils on this particular slide. Other than say that in tunnel mode, you end up getting a new IP header, and the original IP header is saved inside the packet. And you can see that here, where we added a new header and we put this header. The original header is in the packet. We need to do that when one of the endpoints is a gateway, and the reason for that is because we need to keep track of the connection endpoints, where the data originated and where it's going to go to, and we also need to keep track of where IPsec is to be applied. So that's really the reason why gateway scenarios require tunnel mode, is because it has these two headers. Moving on to slide 19, we see some diagrams that are actually stolen from the configuration assistant tool, and they're just another way of showing the gateway to gateway, gateway to host, host to host, and host to host the gateway scenarios here, and you'll see these diagrams in our GUI if you use it. And the key thing to remember is only host-to-host could use transport mode. Everything could use tunnel mode. Now, on the next slide, slide 20, I'm showing you the sort of the operation for creating an AH header. I'm not really going to go into the detail other than to point out the sort of the important things about AH. And the first important thing is that when you're using the AH protocol, you're only getting authentication. You're not getting encryption. So your data isn't secure from being seen as it goes across the internet. All you're doing is you're saying is as it goes across the internet or a particular network segment that you can tell if it's been modified as it's been sent. And the other interesting thing is that for the AH protocol, when they created it, they decided to also authenticate some of the data that's in the IP header. And you'll see on the next slide that the ESP decided not to protect the IP header, and I don't really understand the rationale for why one did and one didn't. On slide 21, I'm showing you basically what we would do if we were constructing an ESP packet. And again, the important thing here is the fact that the IP header is not protected, but you have the ability to encrypt the data that's in the payload. What in the IPSec community, there's a big belief that the AH protocol should just be sunsetted and abandoned, and that we should only use the ESP protocol. But there are some people that feel important enough about protecting that IP header that it keeps the AH protocol in the standard. Moving on to slide 22, this just reinforces some of the things I've said about the SA itself. I mean, it's a recipe, as I said. It says how to build an IPSec packet. And so the first thing that you have to decide in that recipe is which protocol are you going to use? Are you going to use AH or ESP? And once you decide which protocol you're going to use, you then have to decide the algorithms you're going to use to protect the data. So if it's ESP and you're using encryption, you will say which encryption algorithm I'm going to use. For example, will I use triple DES or will I use AES? And if it's doing authentication, you'll figure out what authentication algorithm you want to use. So you'll figure out whether you want to use MD5 or SHA-1. These algorithms require cryptographic keys in order to work, so you also part of this recipe are the particular keys you will use for this particular SA. And I already showed you that encapsulation mode is the ways that you can build an IPSec packet, and you'll have to decide which one you're going to use, tunnel or transport mode. But this is all the information that's really in an SA. It's the type of information that's in an SA. And there's also some lifetime information that are really just for dynamic SAs that you don't really need to worry about too much. But these are what we're talking about when we refer to the term security association. And as I keep saying, there are two ways to manage IP security associations. You could manually configure them, and we're going to talk about that in the next slide, or you could dynamically create them using the IKE protocol. Moving on to slide 23. As you see, manual SAs are not commonly used. They're actually difficult to manage, and they don't scale very well. Ironically, though, when we were doing our USG V6 testing, they used manual SAs to a large extent in testing our capability, our algorithm capability, because it gives them very fine control over what's being used. You have to specify every single thing that's being used. Manual tunnels are defined in the policy agent IPSec configuration file, and the config assistant GUI will support their creation. As I mentioned on the previous slides, all those items that make up the SCSA recipe must be agreed to and then configured. So you agree to them out of band with your peer, and both of you enter the parameters into your configuration file. Manual SAs can be automatically activated when policy is loaded. We have an option that says auto-activate a manual SA. We can also use the IPSec command to activate or deactivate a particular manual SA. One of the things that makes manual SAs a little awkward is that there's some operational issues with them. So if you need to refresh the keys you're using to protect your data, they're disruptive. You have to actually bring down the manual SA, and you have to restart the SA with the new keys. And when you do that, you actually have to time it with your peer doing it at the same point in time. So you can see how it gets rather burdensome to manage these SAs. I mean, even if for some reason on your end something happened that caused you to restart a manual SA, you may have to tell your peer on the other side to restart his SA, and that's because we have sequence numbers that need to kind of be agreed to when we're using these SAs. So over here on slide 24, we kind of have a pictorial view of manual SAs. This diagram is very similar to the diagram I showed you earlier about IP filtering. There's only a couple of different things here. The first thing that's different is you notice that I don't show the default filter rules in this box anymore, because with manual tunnels, you can't use the default filters, or with default filters, you can't use manual tunnels. You have to use the policy agent generated configuration files for manual tunnels. And you'll see now we also added this little box here, which is the SA that is configured. So that tells the stack how to protect the data. And you'll see that the other difference in this picture from the general filtering one is that I now mentioned that you could control which manual SAs are active via the IPSec command. Now we're going to transition from manual SAs to dynamic SAs. So on slide 25, you see that we first bubble on the thing says currently state of the art, and I always get a kick when I see that on the slide, because as I mentioned, dynamic SAs have been state of the art now for a dozen years or so. I mean, the standard came out in 1998, and I guess it's still state of the art. But when you see currently state of the art, you think of something new, and that's not necessarily the case with dynamic SAs. In the long run, dynamic SAs are easier to manage, but they do require a good deal of thought up front, and there is a very large learning curve to getting your arms around dynamic SAs. But once you do, life becomes easier. They're more scalable than manual SAs, and they address all those shortfalls that you have with manual SA keying and timing of the bringing up the SAs. The Internet Key Exchange, or IKE, as I said, is another IETF protocol that describes the method for dynamically managing the SAs. That protocol utilizes a user space daemon or server to negotiate the dynamic SAs. So there's something out of the TCPI stack. It's an application that runs that is used to tell the stack what the SAs are that it should use, and it agrees with a remote security endpoint as to how we want to protect a particular set of data. When you configure dynamic SAs, you're really defining these reusable templates that kind of say, "Here's how I'm willing to protect a particular set of traffic." So I might say, "Well, I don't really care which encryption algorithm I use, as long as you're willing to use either DES, triple DES, or AES." And when I'm going to use authentication, I want to use SHA or HMAC-MD5, either one of those is good. So they're far more flexible. You don't have to say the exact parameters. The exact parameters will get negotiated between the two endpoints, but you do at least have control over what the subset of possibilities are. When the IKE protocol is running, the daemons need to kind of authenticate with each other to know who they're talking to. And at the bottom of the slide, it talks about the fact that there are two authentication methods, pre-shared key and digital signature. Pre-shared keys are easier to use and often used in initial deployments, but generally, if you're going to have a large number of IPSec peers, you're going to end up using digital signature support. As I mentioned, the IKE protocol uses a user space daemon that communicates to a remote user space daemon running the same protocol, and agrees to how to protect a particular set of traffic. It uses a two-phase approach to doing this. In the first phase, we agree on how we're going to authenticate each other, and we create a secure channel that protects the second phase. And in the second phase is where we use to actually negotiate the dynamic SAs. There are two versions of IKE. The original one was defined in RFC 2409, and it's generally just known as IKE, or we call it IKE V1. And the newer version is IKE V2, and that was defined in two RFCs. The first one was 4306, and the second one was 5996. And the only difference is that some clarifications and some general practices were added to 5996 to make it more clear how to implement the protocol. The IKE daemon obtained its policy from policy agent. There's a couple of different types of policies that you could have for dynamic SAs. The first one is dynamic VPN actions. It basically is those templates I told you about that says how to protect the data. The second one is key exchange policy, which you could kind of think of the equivalent of key exchange policy being the IP filter equivalent for the IKE daemons. It's the thing that generates the phase used to generate the phase one essays. And then you have local VPN policy, dynamic VPN policy. I call it dynamic VPN policy. And that's used by the IPSec command for command activation, and also when you want to automatically create an SA when the stack comes up or policy is loaded, you would use auto activation and define entries in that local dynamic VPN policy. And the two daemons that are running are going to use the UDP ports 500 and 4500 to communicate with each other. That's the ports that the IKE protocol defines for communicating. So on page 27, we basically just see some more information about these two phases. One of the things I'll point out here is that phase one and phase two are really IKE V1 terms. They don't really exist in IKE V2, but the general concept is still there in IKE V2. So in IKE V2, we use different terminology. We wouldn't call a phase one SA a phase one SA in IKE V2. We'd call it an IKE SA. So, but if you hear IKE SA and phase one SA, they're pretty much equivalent. And if you hear phase two SA or IPSec SA or phase two SA child SA, they're pretty much equivalent too. In both IKE V1 and IKE V2, once we have a secure channel established, we use it to negotiate the SAs that will be used in conjunction with the AH and ESP protocol. So that's what this little thing here is showing, is that we create that secure channel, and then from that secure channel, we create SAs that are IKE SAs that then protect data. There are four ways to activate a dynamic XA. The stack could receive an outbound packet that matches a rule that requires a dynamic SA, and currently there is no dynamic SA for it, and that's known as on-demand activation. A remote security endpoint could request that you create a dynamic SA, and that's known as remote activation. As I said earlier, the IPSec command can be used to create a dynamic SA, or you can auto-activate it, and so command activation and auto-activated SAs. So other terminologies you may read about in the publications, or you may hear us talk about if you talk to us about IPSec. On slide 29, you see the same old diagram that we saw for filtering manual tunnels. Now it's been changed to show what's different for dynamic tunnels. In dynamic tunnels, the big difference is really just this IKE box here. And it's a recap of what I said. We have key exchange policy, local dynamic VPN policy, and dynamic actions. The IKE daemons communicate over ports 500 and 4500 UDP ports, and it has its own SAs that it uses for those phase one negotiations that it manages, and the IPSec command can be used to control phase one and phase two SAs. You'll see that the SAs that we do create get installed in the stack, and the IPSec logic in the stack just uses those essays. Now we're going to kind of transition to the specialized topics that I alluded to earlier. The first specialized topic is known as NAT traversal. NAT stands for network address translation. A NAT box modifies IP addresses and IP packets. Some NAT devices provide a one-to-one translation of IP addresses. In this case, it would take one address behind the NAT and translate it into a unique routable address. So, for example, it may take the very specific IP address of 192.168.1.1 and change it to a globally routable address such as 129.482.58.10. That's pretty much not used very much these days. What's more used is the second type of NAT, which is called a network address and port translation NAT, and that does a many-to-one translation of IP addresses. So in that scenario, you might have an entire subnet that can map to the same IP address, and that's actually what my NAT box at home does. My router at home has a NAT in it, and that's how it allows me to have multiple endpoints behind it, but it only has one global internet IP address that it uses. Explaining how NAT breaks is kind of really beyond this presentation, but if you want to know the details, there is an RFC 3715 IPSec network address translation that really discusses all the compatibility issues with NAT. The key thing here is that without special support for NAT traversal, you see on the bottom here that you kind of need to use these cascaded IPSec SAs, which really just means you have an SA that goes from H1 to the gateway, it stops, and a new one is created from the gateway to the second gateway, it stops, and a new one is created from the second gateway to the host. And the bad thing about that is you're doing encryption, decryption at all those cascaded tunnels. So the solution is that traversal, and what we use to implement our NAT traversal solution are, as you probably guessed by now, RFCs defined by the IETF. Two RFCs that we use are RFC 3947, negotiation of NAT traversal in IKE, and RFC 3949, UDP encapsulation of IPSec ESP packets. These solutions aren't perfect. They don't address everything. Sometimes protocols embed IP addresses within their data, like FTP is an example of it, and sometimes NAT boxes try to change those addresses for us, but if a box did that with our support, we actually couldn't do it because the data is protected. So we don't have the ability to deal with NAT traversal scenarios where applications have data in them. And it also doesn't address the AH protocol. As I said earlier, we focus our support on the host row, so the NAT traversal support that we implemented are the host-to-host and host-to-gateway scenarios where ZOS is acting as the host. We don't have any support for gateway support where we're acting as the gateway. But we do support both types of NATs that I mentioned, which is the one-to-one and the one-to-many mappings, the NAT and the NAPT. Moving on to the next topic is something known as System-Wide Security Associations, or SWASA. So on slide 33, we see a brief introduction to SWASA. With SWASA, a DVIPA is used as the local security endpoint. DVIPAs are defined in the TCP/IP profile using the VIPA dynamic statement. There are two types of SWASA support. The first one is known as SysFlex Distributor Support, and that's pretty much what this diagram is showing. With SysFlex Distributor Support, IPSec detected connections are distributed across many LPARs. So over here you would have a distributor, and he would distribute the SA across these LPARs. When the distributor receives an IPSec protected packet, it is able to decrypt the packet and then encrypt the response back if it needs to. The coupling facility over here on the left is used to store state, mainly the sequence numbers that are needed to be shared across all the target LPARs in the SysPlex. When you use the distributor, all these LPARs have to have consistent filter policies defined on them, and that's something that the administrator of those LPARs is responsible for. The second technology that we have with SWASA is called VIPA takeover support, and this is where IPSec Phase 1 and Phase 2 SAs are automatically restarted on a backup stack if the primary fails or if you decide to move it from the primary to the backup. The Phase 1 and Phase 2 information is stored in the coupling facility, and then we use that information to generate new ones as we move from the primary to the backup. And once again, on the primary and backup, you have to have consistent IPSec policy, and that is up to the administrator to do. Key thing though, to mention, in order to use this SWASA support, there's an IPSec statement in the TCPI profile, and that IPSec statement is used to define the default filter rules, but it's also used to say that you want to enable this SWASA support. Next special topic is network security service for IPSec. The network security server provides two types of services. One is for IPSec monitoring, and the other is for digital signature support. IPSec monitoring, I already mentioned that there's a Tivoli product that uses an NMI to monitor IPSec. When it does that, it's using the NSS monitoring support. The digital signature services allows for the centralization of racket certificates and private keys. When Ike is configured to use the digital signature services, it offloads its signature creation and verification operations to the NSSD, and that comes into play during that Phase 1 authentication I talked about earlier, where you can use digital signature support. Also down on the bottom of the page here, we mentioned that some of the more advanced features that I'm going to talk about in a second require use of the NSS server, as does our Ike V2 support if you're going to use digital signature authentication. Ike V2, we've already kind of talked about it a couple of times, but here on slide 35, we show that remember Ike V2 is a different protocol than Ike V1, so it's similar to Ike V1, it just uses different terms and have different flows. The key thing here, though, is that our implementation speaks both Ike V1 and Ike V2, and that another key thing on this slide is that for NAT traversal to work or CIS-wide security associations with the SWASA support, you actually need to be on V1R13, but in V1R12, we have Ike V2 support without SWASA and NAT support. Moving to slide 36, we see something called certificate revocation list support. A CRL is a list of certificates that have been revoked by a certificate authority. The slide shows a whole bunch of internal flows that I'm not going to go over. The important things to know about with our CRL support is that we have three modes of CRL checking. One of them is strict, where the revocation information must be available for all certificates and is checked for all certificates. Loose says revocation information is checked if it's available. This is actually our default, but recall that if you're not using NSS services, that you end up not being able to use this particular function, and so loose ends up being the same as none. And none says we're not going to check CRLs, and you know, the reason you might not want to check CRLs is because it is a rather expensive operation. We do have to go out and retrieve the CRLs and then deal with them. So you might have a CA that you trust, or you might have another way to deal with revoked users, so that's why you might choose none. The mode is really specified in the key exchange policy or the key exchange action, because CRLs are Phase 1 types of things because they deal with the digital signature authentication. When we retrieve a CRL, we're using information within a certificate that we're trying to verify, specifically a field known as the CRL distribution point extension. And there are restrictions on what's supported, so I would recommend you look at the key exchange policy statement in the configuration reference for details. But in general, we want that serial distribution point to have an HTTP URL in it. And likewise, we want the serial to be issued for all revocation issues, not just a subset of the revocation issues I guess a CA, when it revokes a certificate, it has the ability to revoke it for a particular reason, and it could generate CRLs for a particular reason, but we don't support those. In general, you really have little control over what's in your CRL distribution point unless you're acting as your own CA. But luckily, most common CAs will use these type of distribution points. Okay, and on slide 37, we see another V1 R12 enhancement, certificate trust chain support. Certificate trust chain support allows IPE demons to learn about subordinate CAs dynamically. So it reduces the number of CAs that the NSS administrator or the IKE administrator needs to keep track of. The theory is simple. If you have a certificate hierarchy like you have over here on the left, and you trust this particular CA, you should trust anything it creates. So if it creates another CA under it, you should trust the certificates that CA creates because you trust the higher CA. So in this example, if you trusted sub CA 1 and you received a certificate like peer here that was signed by sub CA 2, you should be able to trust that certificate because you trust sub CA 1. Prior to IKE V2 or prior to IKE V1 R12, we didn't do that. So what we would do is we would require that sub CA 2 had to be on our keyring before we would trust IKE peer. But starting in IKE V1 R12, which was our IKE V2 implementation, and we actually implemented this for IKE V2. We now support the ability for our peer to tell us about missing pieces of the CA hierarchy and us to use those missing pieces to validate the certificate. And it's actually very easy for our peer to know what we're missing. So this all works pretty well, and it works nicely, and it really reduces complications and it fosters interoperability. This page just lists the algorithms that we supported prior to V1 R12 and the new ones that we added in V1 R12. And I'm not really going to discuss those. They're pretty self-explanatory. Our last little special topic is FIPS support. So we have support for FIPS 140. FIPS stands for Federal Information Processing Standard. It governs the integrity and functions of cryptographic modules. You can think of a cryptographic module as a place that cryptographic operations take place. The diagram, if you look, the boxes in orange in the figures show where cryptographic operations are done when IKE, NSSD, and the stack are not operating in FIPS 140 mode, and it shows where they're being done when they are. The big difference is when those daemons are running and the stack is running in FIPS 140 mode, all cryptographic operations happen in system SSL or ICSF. And both of those particular modules have to have FIPS 140 enabled as well. You specify which level of FIPS you want in effect for a stack at a stack level. However, if one stack is using FIPS 140 mode, then IKE-D and NSSD also have to be configured using FIPS 140 mode. Multiple stacks could actually use one IKE or one NSSD. So, we're going to move on to the IPSec security and displays controls. And I said we're going to go very briefly about that, about these. This is it. This one foil. And all I'm going to say is that there are more options than appear on this foil, but those are for things like NSSD itself or the Defense Manager. And the key things that you're going to use on this are the -F for filters, -K for Phase 1 SAs or IKE SAs, and -Y for dynamic SAs. Those are the commands you'll use the most often. Now we're going to talk briefly about configuring IPSec displays and controls. not quite as briefly as we did with the managing the IPSec, but configuring the IPSec, we'll talk in a little bit more detail. This is a picture we've seen. The only thing I'm going to mention with it now is to remember that these things, policy agent, IKE, TRMD, syslogd, and NSSD, are all daemons or servers that are running on an image, and you have to configure those particular daemons. And so we'll see that as we go through the configuration steps here. Moving on to slide 44. Slide 44 lists a set of tests that may be needed to be completed in order to use IPSec on ZOS. The reason I say may is because depending on what features of IPSec you plan to use, some of these features may not be relevant. For example, if you're not going to use IPSec filter rules that require IPSec, if you're just going to use permit or deny rules, you're not going to need to configure IKE-D or the network security service daemon. As I mentioned earlier, there are several things you need to update in the TCP/IP profile. Those are things like saying, yes, I want to enable IPSec by specifying IPSec support on the IP config statement, or enabling SWASO support, or defining the default filter rules. All these daemons that we run, they need to have their own configuration file, and they need to have their own started procedure, JCL, to start them. There are a few things that require SAF access controls to be defined. For example, the IPSec command requires a SAF profile to be defined in order to control who can use the command. The NSSD server requires a serve-off profile to identify who could use particular, which IKE daemons could use particular certificates on its key rings. You may need to configure ICSF. You need to define the IPSec security policy. You do that per stack. And as I said, you could use the GUI to define that. And then you may need to create a SAF key ring if you're going to use digital certificate support and digital certificate or digital signature support. And most likely you will be using that if you're using dynamic assays. Good news is that starting in V1R11, the configuration assistant at least provides you with a list of these tasks and can guide you through the preparation of these tasks. Moving on to slide 45, we see the flash panel for the config assistant. It's a GUI tool, and it actually manages multiple disciplines besides IPSec. It handles things like IDS, ATTLS policy, QoS policy, PVR policy. I'm only going to talk about IPSec policy today. There are two versions of the GUI. One is a part of the ZOSMF web-based interface, and then there's a standalone Windows application that you could use. The URL for the standalone GUI is down here, so if you want to play with it, you could. And what the GUI is going to do for you is it's going to create your IPSec policy file that you could upload to your ZOS image and have policy agent read. The good news is if you already started configuring your own IPSec policy and you want to switch to the GUI, you can do that. The GUI does support importing existing policy files into it. I haven't used that feature. I don't know how well it works, but I assume it works well. On slide 46, you'll see the GUI's IPSec task list. It guides you through the steps that you need to configure IPSec, basically the things I mentioned on the previous page. The intent of slide 47 is to show you the relationships between the various objects in the GUI. I'm going to quickly walk through the steps listed on this page. The intent when I walk through these steps is not for you to understand the steps, rather than just to get a feel for the relationship between the objects. So starting out here, this is actually a GUI panel, and what you see is I'm in the IPSec perspective, so I'm only seeing IPSec-related stuff, and I'm going to select create a new image, because the first thing it said to do on the previous page was create an image. So here I am on the new image page. You see there's not much to that. I just describe the image. I say what release I want this image for, so I could from the GUI manage a R13 image, and I could also manage an R12 image. And on this particular image, I'm saying I want to use dynamic tunnels so we could actually see that. So now here I am on, I think, slide 50, that is, with my new image created. And I'm going to pick the add a new TCP IP stack option. So now I'm going over here, and you see that I'm creating a new stack. I tell that stack I want to have dynamic tunnels. I bring up the IPSec perspective, and you see that the new stack has been defined here, but it tells me that the stack is incomplete. The reason it's incomplete is because I haven't defined any policy for it yet, or haven't defined any filter rules. So I'm going to work on creating filter rules throughout the next part of this. You'll see that before I can create a filter rule, I need something called a connectivity rule. And before I create a connectivity rule, I need something called a requirements map. Those are things that were shown on the slide 47. To create a requirements map, I need traffic descriptors. So I'm now showing that I can come up here and pick traffic descriptors, and I'm going to look at a particular traffic descriptor. This new one here is for the FTP server. Slide 53 shows the details of the traffic selector. A traffic selector is a generic description of a traffic pattern without regard for IP addresses. So you describe all the traffic pattern except the IP address. So you see down here you define what protocol, what ports you want to this particular descriptor to apply to. You say for TCP connections who should create the connection, whether it's inbound creator or an outbound packet creates the connection. And then you could also say which directions the packet flow. In this case, they're flowing either direction. So now that I have a traffic descriptor to create a requirements map, I also need a security level. So I'm going to add a security level here. So slide 55, I start creating my security level. And I, again, say I want to use IPSec. This time I'm going to use dynamic IPSec. I go to the next slide, which shows that I have to pick which way I want to encrypt and authenticate my IPSec packets. And here I'm using triple DES and HMAC MD5. Then I have some advanced settings, which I'm not going to show you, but you get an idea that security level is basically saying how I want to protect the packet. So now that I have a security level and I have a traffic descriptor, I can combine those together to create a requirements map. So this is basically now saying any traffic that meets this pattern, I have the requirement to protect it the way specified in the security level. Now, I'm going to kind of take a jump out of creating the connectivity rule, and I'm going to create an IP group. And the only reason I'm doing that is because it was shown on slide 47. But as you can see here, an IP group is just a bunch of IP addresses or IP subnets that are defined and grouped together. And so if you want to create the same rule for multiple endpoints, you could use a group. So now that I have my group, or a group, I'm going to create a connectivity rule. A connectivity rule is really going to tie an IP address now to that requirements map that I just created. So it's adding that missing piece of information that wasn't there for the requirements map. On slide 61, you'll see something that should look familiar. It's the diagrams that I showed earlier in the presentation that describe the scenarios. In this case, I picked host to host. I move to the next slide where it wants to know the data endpoints. This is where the data is originating and going to. And in this particular one, I decided to use the IP, the address group that I created earlier, which was named source. And I also had created another one named destination earlier. Just didn't show you that. I now want to say, with this rule, I have these IP addresses that I want to protect, apply IPSec to. What exactly with those IP addresses do I want to protect? And that's what the requirements map is. So this is where I'm saying I'm just going to protect the FTP server traffic with this particular connectivity rule. Now, the next two slides basically just show you the security endpoint. So that's where the IPSec protection is going to be applied. as I said, in this particular case, I'm using host-to-host, so it's really being the local security endpoint equals the data endpoints, and I specify some ID information about both of those, and I finish. And now I have a connectivity map, a connectivity rule. And if you go back to the IPSec perspective, you see that the rule has been defined, and we no longer have that red X over here on the stack. This is now has valid policy. It only has one policy. If I were to use this thing now, the only thing I would be able to do is do IPSec traffic between the source and the destination, and it would only be for that FTP server traffic. Every other piece of traffic would be denied because I didn't define any more rules. So that's the quick step through the GUI. Now I'm going to talk very quickly about what's needed with the key rings. So slide 68 moves to the topic of certificates and key rings. This picture is a bit complicated, so I'm going to use some animation to break it up. The first piece is pretty simple. We have an Ike daemon. That Ike daemon wants to use a digital signature mode of authentication, so it needs to have its own key ring, or it has to use NSSD. In this case, let's assume it's using its own key ring. The first thing it needs on its key ring is the certificate it's going to use to create its signature. Let's assume the remote endpoint's doing the same thing. So the remote endpoint would also have a private key and a personal signature on its key ring. In order for the certificates to work, I have to have the CA that I trust has to be on my key ring. So for me to trust the certificate for Ike B, Ike A has to have the CA that signed Ike B certificate on its key ring, and likewise, Ike B needs CA certificate on its A certificate on its key ring. And generally, you also keep all the certificates in the hierarchy of the CA that signed your certificate, and that's actually needed if you're going to use the CA hierarchy support that reintroduced in B1R12. If you want it to work well, you need to have all the certificates in. So that's pretty much what you need on your key ring. Generally, you'll use different keys and different for different endpoints. So if you have multiple endpoints, you'll probably have different private keys and different personal certificate for that. So the picture between this slide and the previous slide is familiar, but it really isn't implying the same thing that the previous slide implied. In the previous slide, I was Ike A and Ike B were negotiating with each other. In this slide, Ike A and Ike B just happened to be two Ike daemons that you own. So if you owned Ike A and Ike B on the previous slide, you could do what is shown on this slide. NSSD can be used to manage the certificates for both Ikes, and it would place those certificates on its key ring. And then you would decide which certificates belong to which daemon by using the Servoth profile. The Servoth profile will control that Ike A only sees Ike A's certificates and Ike B only sees Ike B's certificates. This is just an example of a RACF JCL that you might use when you're just starting out doing IPSec and you want to create your own certificates to play with. This shows you how to do that. And moving on to slide 72, I'm just going to recap. Hopefully I've convinced you that we have a robust IPSec implementation. We support both host and gateway roles, but we're optimized for the host role. We provide net traversal support. We support both IPv4 and IPv6. We give you a GUI to define your configuration, but you don't have to use that GUI. We have this default policy that protects the stack until real policy can be loaded or the policy agent policy could be loaded. I mentioned we have robust cryptographic support, so here are the algorithms that we support. And I also mentioned that we could be used with Ike B1 and Ike B2, and that we support the most common versions of the RFCs. Next slide just shows you where you can go for some more information in general, and the final slide, which actually shows you the social media links that we have.